Arms of God. in the snow. Thank you, Lord.
Just want to thank you, Lord.
Just want to thank you, Lord.
For everything you've done for me. Thank you, Lord. I just want to thank you, Lord. Just want to thank you, Lord. For keeping me whole, saving my soul. Thank you, Lord.
For my whole family, for the joy my children bring, shoes on our feet, plenty to eat. Thank you, Lord. For the church where I worship and pray, for the freedom I have today, for the spirit I feel, presence so real. Thank you, Lord.
I just want to thank you, Lord.
So dear, giving my sad heart cheer, holding my hand when I could not stand. Thank you, Lord, for giving your life for me on a cross at Calvary, taking my place, mercy and grace. Thank you, Lord.
Any good? Let's turn our Bibles to John chapter 3. John chapter number 3. While you're turning, we'll praise the Lord this morning for an offering of $1,241. John chapter number 3. Found your place, we'll ask you to stand this morning. We'll read the Word of God here in John chapter 3. I'm going to read the first 7 verses, and then we'll eventually make our way to Romans chapter 5 and secondly to 2 Timothy chapter 2, and then Romans chapter number 5. But we'll start here in John chapter 3 this morning. Very familiar scripture. Verse 1, there was a man of the Pharisees named Nicodemus, a ruler of the Jews. The same came to Jesus by night and said unto him, Rabbi, we know that thou art a teacher come from God, for no man can do these miracles that thou doest, except God be with him. Jesus answered and said unto him, Verily, verily, I say unto thee, except a man be born again, he cannot see the kingdom of God. Nicodemus saith unto him, How can a man be born when he is old? Can he enter the second time into his mother's womb and be born? Jesus answered, Verily, verily, I say unto thee, except a man be born of water and of the Spirit, he cannot enter into the kingdom of God. That which is born of flesh is flesh, and that which is born of the Spirit is spirit. Marvel not that I said unto thee, Ye must be born again. Father, I thank you for your word today, and I pray, Father, that you would allow it to lodge in the heart of every person in the building today. God, we're so thankful today for what our veterans represent, what they have done. We're thankful today, Lord, for what you have done. And God, I pray that you'd give us strength and you'd give us the same courage, Lord, that it takes, Lord, for these veterans. Lord, give us that same courage spiritually, Lord, to be able to stand and face adversity of the spiritual realm, and help us to be a veteran of the faith today. We'll praise you for all that you do. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen. You can be seated. Thank you for standing this morning in reverence to the Word of God. I have a couple of things that I would like to read today. I don't normally do this, but I've got a couple of things that I'd like to read. One of them you've probably heard before that I'll read just a little while, but this one, I don't know if you've heard this or not. I want to preach this morning on, are you a veteran? Are you a veteran? Now, I know that earlier we asked the veterans to stand, and there was four or five or six of them in the building today as far as veterans of the U.S. Armed Forces, whatever branch that you served. But what I'm asking each and every one of us today is, are you a veteran in the army of God? Are you a veteran of the faith today? What does it take? What does it mean to be a veteran? What does it take to be a veteran? And are you a veteran? Does others, when others look at you, do they consider you to be a veteran? Do they honor you for your faithfulness? Do they honor you for your commitment, your dedication to the Lord, to the church, to the things of God? That's what I want to do today. But before I get into that, I'd like to read this. I thought this was very, very good. This is a poem called "I Am a Veteran" by Andrea Brett. You may not know me the first time we meet. I'm just another you see on the street. But I am the reason you walk and breathe free. I am the reason for your liberty. I am a veteran. I work in the local factory all day. I own the restaurant just down the way. I sell you insurance. I start your IV. I've got the best looking grandkids you'll ever see. I'm your grocer, your banker, your child's school teacher. I'm your plumber, your barber, your family's preacher. But there's part of me you don't know very well. Just listen a moment. I've a story to tell. I am a veteran. I joined the service while still in my teens. I traded my prom dress for camouflage greens. I'm the first in my family to do something like this. I followed my father like he followed his. Defying my fears and hiding my doubt, I married my sweetheart before I shipped out. I missed Christmas, then Easter, the birth of my son, but I knew I was doing what had to be done. I served on the battlefront. I served on the base. I bound up the wounded and begged for God's grace. I gave orders to fire. I followed commands. I marched into conflict in far distant lands. In the jungle, the desert, on mountains and shores, in bunkers, in tents, on dank earthen floors. While I fought on the ground, in the air, on the sea, my family and friends were home praying for me. For the land of the free and the home of the brave, I faced my demons in foxholes and caves. Then one dreaded day, without drummer or fife, I lost an arm. My buddy lost his life. I came home and moved on, but forever was changed. The perils of war in my memory remained. I don't really say much. I don't feel like I can. But I left home a child and came home a man. There are thousands like me, thousands more who are gone. But their legacy lives as time marches on. while white crosses in rows and names carved in queue remind us of what these brave souls had to do. I'm part of a fellowship, a strong, mighty band of each man and each woman who has served this great land. And when, oh glory waves, I stand proud, I stand tall, I helped keep her flying over you, over all. I am a veteran. Isn't that good? So much in that that we relate to, those who have served, those who have family that have served, and it does something to us when we think about the sacrifice, and when we think about the commitment and the dedication and the courage that it took to do what had to be done. And again, as I said earlier, we stand here today. I stand before you today in a behind a pulpit in a church building as of today without fear of the government, without fear of somebody coming in and shutting us down and pointing guns at us and taking away our Bibles. And the only reason that I can stand before you today in that freedom is because of those veterans that have served. But there's another veteran to me that is the greatest of all veterans. His name is Jesus. The courage and the commitment and the dedication that took for him to do everything that he did. You see, we forget a lot of times that when God came to the earth, he came to the earth as a man. And he submitted and subjected himself to all of the things that man would face. All the perils, all the trouble, all the doubts, all the temptations, and you know, everything. And he endured all of that. And he committed himself and dedicated himself to the mission. And at any point in the process, he could have went home. The Scripture teaches us that he had legions of angels at his disposal, that at any moment he could call, they would usher him back into the presence of his Father in glory. End of story. And you and I wouldn't be here today. But the Scripture teaches us that he set his face toward Jerusalem. And the Scripture teaches us that he was obedient unto death, even the death of the cross. He did what had to be done. And today we stand in spiritual freedom today because of what he did. But not only because of what he did, but because of what others have done in this in this way called Christianity. We look at the fathers of our faith. We look at Abraham. We look at Noah, we look at Isaac and Jacob, we look at Elijah and Elisha and all these people. And you know, Hebrews chapter 11 lists a whole bunch of them. And we look at all of those. And Hebrews 12 verse 1 says, "Wherefore, seeing we are compassed about with so great a cloud of witnesses, let us lay aside every weight and every sin that does so easily beset us, and let us run with patience the race that is set before us, looking unto Jesus, the author and finisher of our faith, who for the joy that was set before him endured the cross, despising the shame, and is set down on the right hand of the throne of God." So what are we doing? Are we carrying on the torch? Are we continuing to lift the banner high? We draw a lot off of what the ones that have gone on before us have done. And we should. And we have that opportunity to draw off their example, to draw off their experience. But at some point in every one of our lives, there's going to be a younger generation that looks at us, and what are they going to think? Are they going to draw off what we did? Are they going to follow our example? At some point, we become the fathers of faith to those that come behind us. You see, we're blazing the trail. We're blazing a trail, whether it be the right trail or not. We're blazing some sort of a trail for the younger generations to follow. You say, well, I don't understand the scripture that you read and what that's got to do. Well, let me just tell you. First of all, in order to be a veteran, you must be enlisted. That's the first step. You must be enlisted into the army of God. And to be enlisted into the army of God is what Jesus has told Nicodemus here. You must be born again. Now notice that Jesus did not say you must join a local body. You must join the local assembly. You must join the local church. Notice he did not say you must be baptized in water. He said you must be born of water and of spirit and of the spirit. Okay? So he says you must be born again. What's he talking about? Listen, he's talking to a man named Nicodemus. Nicodemus, the scripture tells us, was a man of the Pharisees and a ruler of the Jews. So one would look at Nicodemus and, I mean, just on the surface, you might think, well, he's a veteran. I mean, he's a veteran of religion. He's a veteran of the Jewish customs. I mean, he was a man of the Pharisees. He was a ruler of the Jews. He probably knew the law of God and the Mosaic system and all of that, frontwards and backwards. But there was something that wasn't right in his life. There was something evidently that was missing, because Jesus takes the opportunity to tell him in verse number 3, except a man be born again, he cannot see the kingdom of God. And when he said that, Nicodemus didn't understand. He said, how can a man be born when he is old? How can he enter the second time into his mother's womb and be born? And Jesus tries to explain to him, verily, verily, I say unto thee, except a man be born of water and of the Spirit. So he's talking about a fleshly birth, and he's talking about a spiritual birth. You see, joining a church does not create a spiritual transformation. We miss that sometimes. Are you a Christian? Well, I'm a member of so-and-so church. That's not the question. If I wanted to know where you're a member, I'd ask you, where are you a member? But the question is, are you a Christian? What does it mean to be a Christian? It means to be a Christ follower. It means to be committed to His ideals and His values and His teachings and all of the things that the Bible teaches. That's what it means to be a Christian. It means, and not only means that you have agreed to these things, but it means that you have trusted Christ as your Savior and as your Lord, and Christ has brought about a spiritual transformation in your heart. And you've been made a new creature in Jesus Christ. 2 Corinthians 5:17, if any man be in Christ, he's a new creature. Old things are passed away. Behold, all things are become new. Okay? So Jesus didn't say that you must do these things. He said you must be born again. He's talking about a spiritual transformation. And I hope that under the sound of my voice today, that everyone that hears what I'm saying today can go back to a place and a time in your life where there was a spiritual transformation that took place. You say, preacher, I'm not exactly sure what you're referring to. Then you have never been born again. I say that with certainty today. Not because I'm God, not because I know the hearts of men, but I'm telling you, if you do not know what I'm talking about, you have never experienced it. Because everyone that has ever experienced this spiritual transformation knows exactly what I'm saying today. I don't remember that time in my life. I'm not asking you to remember a date. I'm not asking you to remember a time of day. I'm not asking you to remember a day of the week. I'm asking you to remember the event. Has it taken place in your life? And if it has, then what happened that day? was not only were you made a new creature in the Lord Jesus Christ through a spiritual transformation, but you were enlisted in the army of God. You become a soldier in His army. That's what happened that day. So the first thing that must take place in order for you to be a veteran is you must be enlisted. Not only must you be enlisted, but then after your enlistment, there must be endurance. Second Timothy chapter number 2, Paul tells Timothy this. He says, "Thou therefore, my son, be strong in the grace that is in Christ Jesus, and the things that thou hast heard of me among many witnesses, the same commit thou to faithful men who shall be able to teach others also." Then he says this in verse 3. "Thou therefore endure hardness as a good soldier of Jesus Christ. No man that warreth entangleth himself with the affairs of this life, that he may please him who hath chosen him to be a soldier." Now let's back up just a second and let's think about this. You know, when someone enlists in the armed forces, now there was a time in our history where there was something called a draft. And when you got that letter, you had to go. But today, the draft no longer is a thing. And so, you know, our young men and women today that enlist into the armed forces of the U.S. military, they think about it. They weigh out the options. They look at the pros and the cons, and they, you know, what, and they make a decision, this is what I want to do. Okay? Well, let me tell you, in the army of God, none of us in this building actually made the decision, this is what we want to do, before He chose us. It kind of reminds me, you know, that old saying and you know, pictures everywhere and monuments and statues and stuff like that. You know, it says, it got this guy up there, you know, with the American flag hat and dressed up like in an American flag suit. And he's pointing his finger and he says, "Uncle Sam wants you." Right? Jesus looked at His disciples. He said, "Ye have not chosen me, but I have chosen you." None of us went looking for God before He came looking for us. Okay? But once He came looking for us, and Paul is saying that in a way to Timothy here, he says, "No man that warreth entangleth himself with the affairs of this life, that he may please him who hath chosen him to be a soldier." In other words, he's telling Timothy, do not entangle yourself with the affairs of this life. You need to be focused on pleasing God who has chose you to be a soldier in His army. And you and I need to have that mindset today, that we don't need to entangle ourselves with the affairs of this life. And boy, I'm telling you, it's easy to entangle ourselves in the affairs of this life. It's easy to get wrapped up in this and wrapped up in that, but we need to be focused today on pleasing Him who hath chosen us to be a soldier. So you must be enlisted and you must endure. What do I have to endure? Everything. Whatever hardships come your way, whatever adversity presents itself, you must be willing, you must be committed and dedicated to the cause enough to go through whatever you have to go through in order to see that the cause of Christ prevails. And sometimes it's quite difficult. Now, I say this, you know, from... I've never been in the military, but I know lots of people that have, and I know from their experience some things that they've had to endure. I'll never forget, 5 or 6 years ago, whenever it was, we went up to Nashville, I believe it was, and saw Aaron as he got in that van with all those other young men and women, and they headed down the road going to Parris Island, South Carolina. Now, I don't remember what time of the day that was. It was kind of, I think, early or maybe midday or something like that. Anyway, we left and came home. And somewhere, I think, between the 11 o'clock hour and midnight, if my memory serves me correctly, our Joy's phone rang. We were expecting a call. We didn't know when it would come, but we knew at some point it was coming. And Joy's phone rang, and, you know, we didn't really know. I mean, we sort of had a little bit of an idea about what to expect, but we really didn't know what to expect. And as soon as she answered the call, it was a two-way conversation. For the next, I don't know, what was it, 15, 20 seconds maybe? If that, 15, 20 seconds, if that. For the next 15, 20 seconds, all we hear is Aaron screaming in the phone. What's he screaming? A scripted message. And in the background, we hear all kinds of screaming. And he's screaming a scripted message for maybe 15 seconds. There is not, "Mama, I love you." There's not, "Daddy, I love you." And that, there's no time. I mean, if we want to tell him we love him, we got to do it over his screaming. And hope that he hears us. And at the end of that, however many seconds it was of him screaming, it was click, gone. We'll not hear again from him for months. And I can't explain to you how I felt laying there in the bed. We were both in the bed at the time. We were not asleep, I don't think, but we were both already in the bed and just kind of waiting on the phone call. And I can't tell you, I can't explain to you how I felt when that call ended. But I thought, "Dear God, there is no telling what he's about to have to endure. What he's already had to endure. What he's going to have to endure." And I don't say that about him in comparison with anybody else that has done it. I'm telling you, everyone that enlists has to, when they put their name on the line, they are committing and they are dedicating themselves to endure whatever they have to endure in order that the cause is fulfilled. May I remind you today that the freedom that you and I experience today is absolutely not free. It has costed a great price for many. It has costed the ultimate price for others. All, you know the saying, all gave some, and some gave all. Our freedom has never been free. Somebody has had to pay the price. And may I remind you today that our spiritual freedom in Christ also is not free. There was a price that had to be paid, and Jesus paid that price at Calvary. He was willing to endure. What are we willing to endure today? Are you a veteran? Have you spiritually signed your name on the line? Have you spiritually dedicated and committed yourself to the cause of Christ? And are you willing to go through whatever you got to go through? Are you willing to endure whatever hardships and adversity come your way? Or did you think that when you signed up for this way, that it was just going to be a life of Riley and a bed of roses from here on out? You see, that's part of the problem. I'm just going to say it. That's part of the problem with the church today is we've lived the life of Riley for so long. For so many decades and so many generations we live, and we've not suffered persecution. And so when persecution does come, when adversity like we've experienced over the last 2 or 3 years does come, we don't know what to do. What is our grandchildren and our great-grandchildren? Let me just ask you this. When they look back on the history of the church, the history of their parents and their grandparents and their Christian faith, when they look back at the year 2020 to 2022, what's our great-grandchildren going to think about it? What kind of impact will our decisions then, what kind of impact will it make on them at that time? Will they be able to look and say, boy, they persevered. Boy, they were really dedicated. They were really committed. Or will they think something else? I'm just asking the question. It's a valid question. In order to be a veteran, you must enlist and you must endure. And the Bible says in Romans chapter 5, let me read about 5 verses here. Romans chapter 5 and verse number 1 says, therefore, being justified by faith, we have peace with God through our Lord Jesus Christ, by whom also we have... Let me back up. By whom also we have access by faith into this grace wherein we stand and rejoice in the hope of the glory of God. And not only so, but we glory... Listen now. And not only so, but we glory in tribulations also. Now this is veterans we're talking about here. Let's ask ourselves the question today. Do we glory in tribulation? Or do we cower, complain, and whine in tribulations? Think about it. They said, we glory in tribulations also. Here's why they gloried in it. Here's how they could glory in it. Knowing that tribulation worketh... Well, we don't like that word, do we? Tribulation worketh what? Patience. You know what patience means in this context? Endurance. Perseverance. And they said we glory in tribulations because what we know is that what is going on in our life right now is working something better for us. You say they were not. You see, they were not focused on the present circumstance. They were focused on what the present circumstance could produce in their future. So they were willing to endure. We said we glory in tribulations also. Now listen, knowing that tribulation worketh patience, and patience, which is endurance, which is perseverance, patience worketh experience. And to be a veteran, you must enlist. You must be willing and commit yourself to endure. And when you have done that, you have gained experience by what you've been able to endure. How many of us have experienced some things in life? In our Christian faith, what have we experienced? Have we experienced God making a way when there seemed to be no way? Have we experienced God making ends meet when the bank account was negative? Huh? Have we experienced God putting food on the table when we were unable to work? Does anybody have any experiences in this Christian walk? You see, every veteran experiences something. First of all, they all have to experience boot camp or basic training or whatever, maybe, I don't know, there may be another term for it in some of the other branches. I know Army calls it basic training, and the Marines calls it boot camp. They experience that, and that's hard enough. But then when they experience basic training or boot camp, which is rigorous, difficult training, because why? Because they are prepared, they are being prepared for what may come in the future. Many of you today, when you enlisted and you went through that, you were being prepared for what would surely come in the future. Those who enlisted in a time of war, they knew it already. I'm being trained so I can go fight. The ones that enlist today are, many of them are being trained so if they have to fight, and they're willing to fight if it comes to that. But they experience all kinds of different things, whether it be domestically, whether it be foreign, whether it be in times of war or in times of peace, there is experiences that they all share as veterans. You see, I can't sit and talk to veterans through my own personal experience because I'm not a veteran. I can sit and listen, and I love sometimes listening to veterans talk about their experiences, and some experiences they will not nor cannot talk about. Some of them have seen things that human eyes shouldn't ever see. Some of them lost their comrades in roadside bombs or in guerrilla warfare or, you know, boots on the ground or whatever the case may be. And some of them can't talk about it today. And that's okay. But for the veterans of the Christian faith, I can sit and I can share experiences with you. You can share experiences with me about how we've come to places in our life that were difficult and God has graciously delivered. He's faithfully delivered. What's your experiences? You see, you don't sign your name on the line to sit and just do nothing. You sign your name on the line to do whatever is necessary, whatever is needful. And sometimes there's times where, you know, the activity is not as much as what it can be, and sometimes it's more than you can bear. Sometimes it's you got more to do than you can shake a stick at, as old saying goes. The question is, are you a veteran today? I want to read one other thing today, and this is maybe something that you might be more familiar with. But this is so good. And I think that if all of us will adopt this mentality, if we don't have this mentality, if we'll adopt it, then God will have an army of faithful and committed individuals that will not cower at things that come our way, but will stand strong in the face of adversity and claim the name of Jesus Christ and lift His banner high. Listen as I read this called I Am a Soldier. I am a soldier in the army of my God. The Lord Jesus Christ is my commanding officer. The Holy Scripture is my code of conduct. Faith, prayer, and the Word are my weapons of warfare. I've been taught by the Holy Spirit, trained by experience, tried by adversity, and tested by fire. I am a volunteer in this army, and I am enlisted for eternity. I will not get out, sell out, be talked out, or pushed out. I am faithful, reliable, capable, and dependable. If my God needs me, I am there. I am a soldier. I am not a baby. I do not need to be pampered, petted, primed up, pumped up, picked up, or pepped up. I am a soldier. Can you imagine? Now, I will say this, and this comes from reliable sources inside. But in some parts of our military today, this is where we've gotten to. In some branches of the military today, if the drill instructor or the drill sergeant says something that you don't like that offends you, you can hold up a card or something like that, and something will be done about it. That's pathetic. It's pitiful. And in our world today, we're raising a generation of pansies. Go ahead, tell them your preacher said so. I don't care. We're raising a generation of pansies that do not know what to do or how to do when adversity comes. And a lot of the reason, I'm going to go, might as well just hit it while I'm here, right? A lot of the reasons is because these young boys and girls were never whipped when they were little. I had no idea I was going to say this today. But I'm going to say it while I'm here. Because there's some parents, possibly in our church today, there's some parents that are in this community that for some reason or another, they think, I'm not going to whip my child. Well, then you're in for a long, hard road, sister. Daddy, you're in for a long journey. Preacher, how do you know it works? Well, for one, because I have experience. Not only was I whipped when I was growing up, when I needed it, but I whipped my children when they needed it. And guess what? They're all right. Have they done things perfectly? No. They've made mistakes along the way. But honey, they're all right. I did not warp their mentality because I whipped them. I did not warp their intelligence in some way. Didn't warp their mind. The psychiatrist today will say if you whip your children, you'll warp their mind. Honey, I'm telling you, according to experience and what the Bible teaches, if you don't whip your children, they'll warp your mind. And a lot of the reason that we have the generation of people today that think they're entitled to everything and don't want, nobody wants to work anymore. Nobody knows how to work anymore. Nobody shows up on the job. Do you know how many people are out there working today and would love to have it just somebody that'll show up? People show up. And if they don't like it, they go home. They quit after one day or half a day of work. Grow up, people. Grow up. How did I get here? We got to get back to the basics. Where working hard is what you do. And committing yourself and being a man of your word and all that, that's what you do. I'm a soldier. I'm not a baby. I do not need to be pampered, petted, primed up, pumped up, picked up, or pepped up. I am a soldier. Imagine where we would be in our United States military forces if all that we had in there was this kind of person that needed to be pampered and pumped up and petted. There's a lot of church people that are like that. They got to be primed up. They got to be pumped up. They got to be petted and pampered. No. We got time for that. Grow up. Be a veteran. Be a soldier. I am a soldier. No one has to call me, remind me, write me, visit me, entice me, or lure me. I am a soldier. Don't get quiet on me now, honey. I am not a wimp. I am in place, saluting my king, obeying his orders, praising his name, building his kingdom. No one has to send me flowers, gifts, food, cards, or candy, or give me handouts. Don't get quiet on me now. I do not need to be cuddled, cradled, cared for, or catered to. I am committed. I cannot have my feelings hurt bad enough to turn me around. This guy had to be a Christian. Whoever wrote this. I mean, he had to be, he might have been a pastor, I don't know, a deacon or something. I cannot have my feelings hurt bad enough to turn me around. I cannot be discouraged enough to turn me aside. Listen, there are things that are going to come in your life. I don't know what. Oh, I'm looking at a screenshot. It said 10:18. I was like, man, I still got a long time to preach. I don't know what time it is. I really don't care. You know that, but I'm commit. There are times in life. There are times in your Christian life that everything is not going to go your way. What are you going to do? Are you going to get your feelings hurt and go home? Are you going to be discouraged enough to sit down and quit? If you are, I wonder what you had to start with. What did you have to start with? Listen, this is not about your agenda. It's not about my agenda. It's about His agenda. That's what it's about. And sometimes people are going to say things that's going to hurt your feelings. Sometimes they meant it that way, and sometimes they don't. But either way, what are you going to do? You can't control what comes out of other people's mouth. You can't control what other people do. But you know what you can control? What you do and how you respond to what other people do. That's what's in your control. So what are you going to do? You going to be a soldier? You going to be a veteran? Or are you going to be a wimp, a weakling? Think about it. I'm committed. I cannot have my feelings hurt bad enough to turn me around. Cannot be discouraged enough to turn me aside. I cannot lose enough to cause me to quit. Whoever told you that signing up for this Christian life was going to be all grand and all rosy? I'm here to tell you, the good far outweighs the bad. But boy, they's some bad sometimes. Amen? They's some bad sometimes. When Jesus called me into this army, I had nothing. If I end up with nothing, I will still come out ahead. I will win. My God has and will continue to supply all of my need. I am more than a conqueror. I will always triumph. I can do all things through Christ. The devil cannot defeat me. People cannot disillusion me. Weather cannot weary me. Sickness cannot stop me. Battles cannot beat me. Money cannot buy me. Governments cannot silence me. And hell cannot handle me. I am a soldier. Even death cannot destroy me. For when my commander calls me from his battlefield, he will promote me to captain and then allow me to rule with him. I am a soldier in the army, and I am marching, claiming victory. I will not give up. I will not turn around. I am a soldier. Let's stand together as I come with a verse of song.
Are you past the point of weary? Is your burden weighing heavy? Is it all too much to carry? Let me tell you about my Jesus. Do you feel that empty feeling? 'Cause shame's done all it's stealing, and you're desperate for some healing. Let me tell you about my Jesus. He makes a way where there ain't no way. Rises up from an empty grave. Ain't no sinner that he can save. Let me tell you about my Jesus. His love is strong and his grace is free. And the good news is I know that he can do for you what he's done for me. Let me tell you about my Jesus. And let my Jesus change your life. Jesus, oh, he makes a way where there ain't.